I'm George. That was on my seat, which is fun because now I'm on a red carpet and I feel like I'm on a premiere of a film in a film festival. Another George that I'm pretty sure you're more familiar with, George Clooney, the actor. In one of his films a few years back, his character was about to give a speech. And he started his speech by saying a very simple and beautiful phrase. He said, "Moving is living." Or as Socrates put it 2,500 years ago, "The unexamined life isn't worth living." So I decided, not 2,500 years ago, only 2.5 years ago, to examine my life and find out who I am by moving constantly. So I left Greece. You understood either from my last name or my accent that I am from Greece. 2.5 years ago, I moved to Germany in a place outside Munich, where I also started my company, the Film Music Composers Agency. It was about the same time period that I met the love of my life, a beautiful cellist from Turkey, that we decided 1.5 years later to get married and live in Turkey, and specifically in Izmir. So you can say too many emotions happened in my life. Athens, Munich, Izmir, maybe Istanbul soon after, no one knows. But emotions means also changing, many changes. Change is a big part of life. And I didn't simply change my country of residence, I also changed my marital status, I changed my line of work, my profession. But there is one thing that none of us, not me, not you, none of us can really ever change. And was very nicely described in a scene from the Argentinian film The Secret in the Rise, where two investigators are going through the evidence to define who the murderer is, and then one of them has an epiphany. And he says to his partner, "You know what? We can change everything. You can change your name, your God, your religion, your house, your hairdo, whatever. But there is one thing that none of us can change. And that is your passion." I mean, you will never change your passion about reproduction or senses. And you will never change your passion about journalism and so on. My passion is directly linked with humanity's two greatest art forms, cinema and music. Why do I define them as humanity's greatest art forms? First of all, if you think about it, almost everyone on this planet, one way or another, has listened to music or watched a movie. In other words, a movie and a song reach multiple more audiences than a poem or a painting or a dance performance or even an opera. Either way, we cannot really co-op nowadays with opera, can we? Ed Izzard, an English comedian, said in one of his stand-up shows, he said, "Opera is just rich people watching large people being shaken by small people." And I kind of agree. But the second most important reason that I find cinema and music humanity's two greatest, by far, art forms, is that I believe that a movie and a song, images, and sounds, separately or even combined, they have the poetic and inspiring power to create magic. And for me, magic isn't something subjective. Magic is objective because we all have a soul, right? To sort of prove what I just said, I would like to make a small experiment. I would like all of you to close your eyes and listen with me only 10 seconds of music, and then you will tell me if you recognized it or not. So please, close your eyes and listen to this music. Anyone recognized it? What?
Godfather.
Okay. Now, that's something, right? You just heard 7 notes performed by one instrument, a trumpet, composed by one composer, linked as a purpose for one film, or a trilogy, if you want. And they are bound together in eternity. I mean, that's the kind of magic I'm talking about. I mean, if you had your eyes closed and you watched the movies, I'm pretty sure some of you maybe have seen the Godfather logo in your head, or you continued the melody if you knew it. Maybe you have seen Marlon Brando holding with his left hand a cat and playing with it with his right hand. This is the kind of magic I'm really talking about. Now, without having your eyes closed this time, I would like to put one more short track, an expert from a track of Nino Rota, the same, the composer of Godfather. And let's see if you will recognize that one. Let's listen to this. Yes? Also Godfather. Well, you're very right and very wrong at the same time. Yes, this melody you just heard was used in the Godfather movie in 1972, but it was originally composed by Nino Rota in 1958 for an Italian film called Fortunella, that apparently only Italians know about it. So the immediate safe conclusions I can say are two. First of all, that seven notes are more than enough to make history and create magic. We've all experienced that already, I think. Secondly, that if they are the right notes, the right brilliant notes created from a brilliant composer, then any time they can be reused in a different context. It doesn't matter if it is Godfather's waltz or Godmother's rumba, it's still a brilliant melody. As a music professor said once, music should be simple, but not simple-minded. My question here today is, do you think we really experience that kind of magic in our lives that often anymore, as we did in previous years and as previous generations did? I personally doubt it. So I think we should examine, first of all, us as an audience and what happened to us in the last few decades. Let's say a baby is born in the 70s, 1972, when Godfather was released, a very nice year. And he grows up naturally with Muppet Show and Daffy Duck and Donald Duck and all the other ducks over there, and Beep Beep. And eventually he could discover Agatha Christie books and maybe the movies based on these books. And if he was lucky enough for his parents to take him into the movies, then he would be very lucky to watch the big screen in the big dark hall, Star Wars and E.T. and Indiana Jones and all these great fun movies back then. And if eventually he would be more attracted to the art of cinema, then he could discover Alfred Hitchcock and Ilya Kazan, Andrei Tarkovsky and Peter Greenaway and Ingmar Bergman. More or less the same thing happened in the field of music back then. If you were born in the 70s, maybe the first names and music you could have heard was from the Beatles and Elvis and Led Zeppelin. But next to them, there were still household names, the names of Beethoven and Mozart and Shostakovich and Stravinsky. And especially the last two, they were pretty current names. I don't know if you know, Stravinsky died in 1971. Shostakovich died in 1975. Very current names. If you move in time 20 years later and you're born, someone is born in the 90s, then he grows up with Power Rangers and Pokemon and Yu-Gi-Oh, whatever that is, I have no idea. And he's lucky enough to watch Star Wars Episode 1, good job there, and Mission Impossible 1, 2, 3, 4, Transformers 1, 2, 3, Spider-Man 1, and Spider-Man 1 again, Rambo 25 and Rocky 9. But you can see it's not really a smooth transition in our entertainment. I mean, clearly today, we don't get the same quality entertaining choices as people had 40 years ago. I have a friend from Athens. She was a radio producer for 35 years. She told me once a story that she started teaching in a college there, radio production, and she entered one of her first days in the classroom and asked the students, "Do you listen to classical music?" And the girl got very excited and said, "Yes, I do. I do listen to classical music. I listen to Vanessa May." Now, what really happened to us is my question. I think what happened to us is very, very beautifully described in a scene of a beautiful French film from the 90s, All the Mornings of the World was the title. And it's the story about the protagonist is a master of viola da gamba in the Baroque period. And there is a scene where he has a young man in front of him and he's about to decide if he will take him as his apprentice or not. So he says to him, "You know, I heard you playing music and you play beautifully and you hold the bow charmingly and all that, but I didn't really hear any music." And then he continued and he said, you can make a living by performing your viola da gamba and make people dance, but you will never be a musician. He was very rough on him, you can say, but he looked straight into his eyes later and he said, can your heart feel? Can your heart recognize the sounds that aren't meant to entertain the king? I think nowadays this is exactly the same question we have to make to ourselves. Can we really recognize the sounds and the images that aren't meant to simply entertain us one evening and forget them the next morning? I started going to film festivals since I entered this business, and I started also giving seminars and workshops to different festivals and universities. And it's not just that I observed the lack of knowledge we have about the lost magic which is out there, you know, waiting for us to discover it, but most importantly, I discovered that there is a lack of understanding between the two most important groups of people within the entertainment industry, which is the producers and the artists, the business people and the artists. They are so different. They're like atheists and religious people. They interpret the whole world totally different. One is thinking money terms, the other is thinking ideas. So I found that quite sad. I wondered, why is this happening? Why don't they speak the same language? They have to work together at one point and create something for us, the audience. But yet, it's not that they don't speak the same language, they are afraid of each other's language. I started having these questions and soon I discovered that it's quite lovely. There are 13,000 films screened in film festivals every year. What is not lovely is the fact that this is approximately the same number of composers graduating every year from music schools, conservatories, and high-level educational institutions that offer what they call music composing for media courses. If that wasn't enough, I discovered that film academies and the universities that they have film and TV faculties, they don't give to their students a single lesson about music in film, which I find it amazingly bad because they skip in their education a very important part of the entire filmmaking process. We are not simply looking at a saturated market of thousands of filmmakers and thousands of composers out there not speaking the same language. We're looking at a market where the two most important groups of people, they lack important knowledge about their own work. Where they teach them music composing for media into the young composers, they don't teach them pen and paper. They teach them their digital toolbox, as I call it. Their hardware, the software, which is a computer, a MIDI keyboard, and that's it. You think Nino Rota wrote these seven notes by going directly to the piano? What I think happens wrong in the educational system today regarding arts is that they skip in their education the most important step in the whole creative process. A composer's music should start from his heart and from his mind, from his soul, before ending up on his fingers. A director's vision equally should also start from his soul, his heart, his imagination before going out and doing that. They don't do that anymore, and this is very bad. They skip a very important step in the creative process, which is about creation. You create something from your soul, after all. My friend, my best friend, he's a composer, incidentally. He told me once a beautiful quote. He said, a good poet writes what he feels, a mediocre poet writes what he thinks he feels, and a bad poet writes what he thinks he must be feeling. I fundamentally believe that within the entertainment industry today, every artist who is working within it, he is really crushed, he is forced to be a bad poet. He is forced to create based on what he must be feeling, while imagining at the same time what us, the audience, later on should be feeling. It's not that there are not good poets out there anymore. Of course there are. But the educational system is not well set to recognize them and nurture them, mentor them. And also us, the audiences, as we said before, we're not really capable anymore to recognize them. Suddenly, great art is for the very few, you know, the weirdos with the scarves and the hats and the brass doing that in Montmartre. It's not like that. Great art and magic is for everyone. And I miss magic, and I miss it so much that I think that there should be some balance between arts and entertainment. Otherwise, we are doomed Our society is actually doomed because of the entertainment choices we are given. Our intellect is affected totally. The way we interact with our friends, the way we share things, is totally affected by the entertainment we are having. I think this should change drastically and quickly and bring some magic back to our lives. The way we can do that, I think, is in order to bring balance to the Force, as Master Yoda said in Star Wars, is that every single one of us, and especially those working in education, they should become Master Yoda themselves. We should become Master Yoda for ourselves, first of all, to discover the magic which is out there waiting for us to discover it. And the people in the education, they should become Master Yoda for the younger generations, to mentor them properly, to guide them, just to show them the path where they can create the magic that is waiting for them, and they cannot find it because of what we are fed through the entertainment industry every single day. We will not simply achieve magic coming back into our lives, we will also achieve creating the Master Yodas of the future generations. Thank you very much.